Well, thank you very much, Mark. I'm just so privileged to be here, and what a joy to the worship and praise is just great tonight. Man, I loved it. What a great team and what a great bunch of people here. And I just want to honor you for just the way you have always displayed a gracious spirit and generosity. And I remember, Mua, we were doing it pretty hard at that time there. And I had a bag which was broken, and Mark just spotted it and just spontaneously bought a bag. And that was the first I'd ever met him, and the first time he really connected with me was to sow a gift to me. And so in our eyes, you've always been someone to remember as a generous leader. And it's been great to watch your church grow and expand. So thank you very much. And what a another thing that, of course, Mark is known for and this church is known for is transition. And you become a legend in our nation. When the word transition is mentioned, this is the church they mention has been so successful in the past. So I have no doubt listening tonight that there's a successful transition coming again. And just listening to your elders speak, I thought, oh my, we were there 2 years ago. I remember that same speech or another version of it. And yet here we are on the other side of it. And the church is thriving and probably in better place now than it's been in years. And our church is going forward and growing from strength to strength. And we're enjoying our new season of life and just loving what God is doing. And people say, oh, I heard you've retired. I said, retired? What a joke. I said, I'm busier now than I've ever been. We're just going for it. And we've had the privilege to go around and minister around in many churches, many different countries, and just there's such a hunger everywhere. My particularly favorite place is among the Chinese. We do a lot of work among the Chinese, and I was up in China last year. I understand now it's difficult for them. It got very hard that they're threatened with jail if they don't just gather in smaller numbers. But we're in a church of about 1,500 to 1,800 people, had two meetings almost back to back, and just the glory of God came. Just amazing to see the presence of God come and the love of the Father. Just people who have never experienced love, just feeling God engaging them with His love. Just amazing. In fact, it was so powerful that in the end, I just couldn't carry on ministering. I was just weeping, just experiencing God, which is, I do that alone in the prayer, but just to have it happen in a meeting. And I thought, oh, I need to pray for the pastor. And so I just went up, touched her, and I was going to pray, but she was gone. And she was on the ground and weeping and then got delivered. And she was my interpreter for the meeting. And so it's all over. And come back. No, she's gone. And the next, I just carried on praying for people. And then the next I looked and she was being helped to her feet by two people and was just about out on her feet. And God did a tremendous healing because they pay a huge price in China to build big churches and to carry the gospel. Great joy for us to see people who they risk their lives and their future, you know, to be able to do the work of God when we have it so easy here. I had an opportunity just only about a month ago to minister to people from Vietnam, about 1,000 people from Vietnam. And we're just talking to the driver, and you never know who people are till you talk with them. I said, oh, well, tell us a bit about yourself. And he said, oh, well, I'm a pastor from Vietnam. He's driving us around. I said, oh, how's it going there? He said, oh, well, pretty good, really. I've only been in jail 4 times. And he said, oh, well, I've learned about how to handle it now. And because we got interested to find, because it's not our experience. We just enjoy freedom and then take it all for granted and then become casual in it all, rather than actually realizing there are people for them to preach the gospel is dangerous. And he said, oh, yeah, the first time I got beaten up. He said, the second time I told them I was a pastor. And he said, then the people in there, all gang members, said, oh, they said, why don't you tell us you were a pastor before? We would never have done that. And so then they protected him. He said, the dangerous ones were the police. But it was great to be there with 1,000 people, and some of them had come from rural villages where they're planting churches, and they had traveled for miles. They'd never been in a plane, never been in a hotel, many of them, and just the hunger for God, hunger for God. There are so many great things happening, and yet there's great things happening here too. So I just want to honor you as leaders because I know you've sacrificed your time. Nothing like this is a coincidence. It comes about because people worked and sacrificed. Amen? Well, Holy Ghost, we welcome you to come. We ask that you would touch our lives tonight. And those things that are relevant to us personally, that you would speak and quicken them in our heart. We want to hear your voice, and we want to be stirred with fresh fire. Lord, we want this next season to be the greatest season, and we can't do that without you to come and help us. So we invite you to come tonight and tomorrow and just revive us as leaders, that we might carry fire in our heart, passion in our spirit, and Lord, ignite others when they see and feel what we carry in the Holy Ghost. So we welcome you to come, Lord. Amen. Why don't you look with me in Ecclesiastes 10 and verse 10. I want to speak tonight, I felt the Lord put it on my heart, a message called Restoring Your Axe Head. Restoring Your Axe Head. Of course, I come in the meeting, everyone's so passionate, I think, oh Lord, I wonder if I got it right, you know. It's horrible when that happens. But I know tonight that there are people that God wants to restore a cutting edge again in your life. And so we see in Ecclesiastes 10 and verse 10, if the axe is dull and you don't sharpen the edge, you have to use more strength. If the axe is dull and you don't sharpen it, it'll take a lot more effort and energy to get the same results. But wisdom is profitable to direct. And so we see a very powerful truth in this, using prophetic language of the axe head. You know, biblically, an axe head is a cutting instrument, and anyone who's done any cutting with an axe realize that when you're cutting wood with an axe, then the most important part is to sharpen the axe. Anyone who's had to chop wood realizes the time spent sharpening the axe is not wasted time. If you have a blunt axe or an axe with a wobbly head, I tell you, life trying to chop wood is miserable. You're always in danger. The axe head will fly off, and the effort required just to split a simple log is very, very difficult indeed. But if you take the time to sharpen it up, use oil and use a file, and you work at it to hone the edge, then you'll find it's just so much easier to split the wood. And so biblically or prophetically, an axe head to me represents the supernatural dimension of the Holy Spirit. It represents to me your ability to have a cutting edge, your ability to penetrate lives, your ability to penetrate the community. And it to me speaks really strongly of the power and wisdom of the Holy Ghost. You know, the church was not birthed in a Bible school. It was birthed in a prayer move. It was birthed in 10 days of prayer when people sought the presence of God to come. And when God came upon them, blunt men and women became a sharp cutting edge that changed the community. We need still the power of the Holy Ghost. We need the wisdom of the Holy Ghost. We need a strong cutting edge in our life. And I don't believe as you get older, you lose that edge. You need to sharpen it and sharpen it till you're sharper and more effective than you've ever been. No place for retirement in the kingdom of God. And so if the axe is blunt, you need to sharpen it. And when you're involved in ministry, many things can cause you to get blunt, and some can cause you to lose your edge altogether. And I believe there are some here tonight where God wants to restore again a cut in your life, restore your ability to be effective, because you've been worn down in the battle that's involved around leadership. Jesus himself constantly renewed his cutting edge. You find him in Mark in chapter 1 and somewhere about 39, 40 or 35, you find it says he's having a great revival. There's great success happening. Well, our tendency is when we're successful is to relax and draw back. But Jesus rose while it was still dark, went into the wilderness alone and prayed. And the Father showed him where he should apply his energy and effort next. See, wisdom from heaven. Of course, everyone around was surprised by that. They'd say, well, look, it's going so well. Everything's so good. Why don't you stay around here? Why don't you stay where there's obviously a flow of blessing? He said, no, I've got sharpness around my cutting edge. This is what I need to do. I am focused on what my Father has called me to do. Said, I do only the things I see my Father doing, and he's showing me I should apply my energy here in this way. Now, that's, you follow Jesus' ministry, you'll find he frequently rose, came aside into the wilderness, and sharpened the edge. There is a sharpening that can only come out of the presence of God. There's no other way you can get it. There's a sharpness comes in your spirit. And when there's a sharpness in your spirit, you're energized. I can't tell you, you know, we had our 70th birthday this year, but I'm more energized than I've ever been. Fired with the Holy Ghost. And it comes out of the place of prayer. There's no other place you can get it. And so if we can learn how to engage God, then our life can be sharpened immensely. I want you to have a look with me in a scripture in 2 Kings chapter 6. And this is the one I want to focus on tonight. And of course, you know the story. Church like this will know this story. But let's just bring something fresh on it tonight. 2 Kings chapter 6. And it's the story of the axe head that was lost, the lost axe head. So let's read it in chapter 6, verse 1. He said, "The sons of the prophet said to Elisha, 'Now, the place we dwell with you is too small for us. We're contained. There's an enlargement needed. And please let us go to the Jordan. Let every man take a beam from there and let us make a place where we may dwell.' And he answered, 'Go.' And then one of them said, 'Well, consent to go with your servant.' He said, 'I will go with you.' And he went with them, and they came to Jordan, they cut down trees. And as one was cutting down the tree, the iron axe head fell into the water. And he cried out and said, 'Alas, master, it was borrowed.' So the man of God said, 'Where did it fall?' And he showed him the place. And so he cut off a stick, threw it in there, and he made the iron float. Then he said, 'Pick it up yourself.' And he reached out his hand, and he took it." So the background of this is the nation is in chaos. Jezebel is ruling. The nation's embedded in idolatry. It's needing reformation. It's needing a move of God. It's needing for the people of God to rise up again. And so Elijah was anointed to start this process, and now the mantle has transferred. There's been a shift in generations taken place. So when the story opens up, it opens up at a time when a transfer has taken place, and now there's a new leader is emerging. His name is Elisha, and God has given him a double portion of what was previously carried, and he's preparing to make impact upon the nation. And so the double portion is, in many ways you could describe it, but basically it's anointing that brings enlargement. God's intention is always enlargement. His intention for you is personal enlargement. His intention for the church is personal enlargement. But it doesn't happen accidentally, it happens intentionally. It refers to a group of people there called the sons of the prophets. I tried to find a bit about them. I did find that many of the prophets had been killed. So it's quite possibly these sons were orphans of those prophets who laid their life down because they honored God. So these are the sons of a generation which have paid a price to carry the gospel, to carry the word of God into a corrupt nation. Cost them their lives. Some of them may have fathers who were still alive, but they would have been preserved supernaturally when they were hidden in a cave, and there certainly weren't many of them. These are called the sons of the prophets. And so that means they have a legacy. They have something that they can draw from. They have something that they're entitled to take hold of. But you know, it never happens unless you take hold of it. I remember I went up to Indonesia one time, and we had a very big church there, and I said, "Look, please let me train your leaders in the ministry of deliverance before we run any revival meetings, and I have hundreds of people come up for ministry, and there's only me and my son." So anyway, this particular trip, I took my son David with me, and we got up there, and they didn't do what I asked them to do. It was a holiday, so they just had an open meeting, and we had 2,000 there. And when the altar call time came, there were more than 1,000 came forward. It seemed like everyone surged up. And we just had people all the way to the back of the building just wanting ministry, wanting the power of God to set them free. And I remember looking, thinking, well, this is sad, isn't it? It's just Dave and me. I said, "Dave, there's just you and me for this one. The team has let us down. There's no one else, just the two of us." So I said, "I'm not going to carry it all. You're going to have to do half it." So there we are. There's a down there. That's your half. I'll do this half. And go for it. And anyway, so we led them all in a prayer. because I believe that deliverance is not just a matter of someone praying for you, it's a matter of divine alignment. Submit yourself to God, you resist, the devil will flee from you. So our approach to it is to teach, align yourself with God, and then it's easy for you to be set free. So we did that corporately, prayed a corporate prayer. I started to pray for people, the power of God came on them. There were people screaming, yelling, there were people set free all over the place. And I'm about halfway back down the room, and then, wow, we're making great progress. All these things happening, it was chaotic. If you were to look at it, it would look chaotic, but so does a surgery when you're in the middle of it. When it's all together afterwards, it's great. It's just when it's in the middle of it, it doesn't look so good, you know? Blood everywhere and mess everywhere. And we had people, all kinds of things going on. And I even had three witch doctors come into the meeting, and they came to curse us. And when I stood up to pray, I wish I'd seen what happened. It was all over too quick. I was looking that way and it happened over here. But my son spotted it. And what happened was they stood up to curse to try and pull the power off me while I'm in the ministry of preaching. And I looked that way, and in a moment, poof, the power of God hit them. They were on the floor and they couldn't get up. The only way they could go was either crawl to the front or crawl to the back. So they crawled to the back to escape. And someone told my son, the three witch doctors here, he ran down the back and he managed to capture one of them and commanded the demons to come out. He got set free. He led him up and he got into an altar call, got saved. And amazing. Anyway, back to the story. So I'm about halfway down all these hundreds of me. I thought, I wonder how Dave's getting on. And I look around and he's kept up with me. He's there and all these people are clawing and reaching and yelling and they're getting set free. And afterwards I said, wow, that was just awesome, Dave. I was so proud of you. I said, what happened? And he said, well, 3 months ago, God told me that what is on your life is my legacy. And I should take hold of it. So he said, for 3 months, I've been taking hold of the anointing on your life in prayer. And he said, now I've got it. I got it. I got it. You can be in a church and all you've got is something borrowed. It's not yours. You've got to make it yours. I've served, my major serving was under two pastors, and what they carried came on me. I got it. There's a way to get it, but then you've got to hold it and grow it. Cutting edge. So the giftings or anointings around each of the pastors that I served as a son came on me. Now, I want to show you just a couple of things, and just before we move on to just these keys around the axe head here, you notice it talks about the sons of the prophets. Sons of the prophets. Now, every believer here is called to operate in the prophetic anointing. Every one of you can hear God. If you can't hear God, then position yourself so you can. How can you lead people if you don't hear God? It's one of the key foundational requirements of all believers, and particularly in leadership, that you hear the voice of God. And not only that, because we can all hear the voice of God for ourselves, that's why in 1 Corinthians 14 it says, all may prophesy, all may prophesy, all may bring a word from God, all may bring something that's inspired by the Holy Spirit that can cut into a person's life and bring encouragement and change in their life. Prophetic gift's an amazing, wonderful gift. All of us can operate in that gift. All of us can. Not all do. You have to make it yours. Okay, there's the first thing. So all may prophesy and work in that realm of the prophetic. And that means you can then operate in the gifts of the Spirit. Every believer can do that. You say, well, I don't do that. Well, then you need to learn because it's your legacy. In 1 Corinthians 12, 7, it says, now the manifestation of the Spirit is given to all for the edification of others. So we see two things in there. One is, the prophetic anointing that enables you to hear God and operate in the supernatural is yours. It's available to you. Secondly, its purpose is for building people. So you're not given the gift of the Spirit to build your ego, to build your identity. The gifts of the Spirit, or the flowing in the gifts and power of the Spirit, is for serving people, for entering their lives with the anointing and power of the Holy Spirit so transformation takes place. And now it's interesting, sons of the prophets, the word son, we just tend to think of someone who's descended from someone, but actually in the Bible, the word in the Old Testament, son, is the word ben, meaning to build the house. So if you're a son, you build the house. So all of us are called to be builders of God's house, our Father's house. And if he plants you in a church, then to be a son is to be a builder in that house. So as a leader, it's not a matter of just serving. It's a matter of I want relationship of sonship with my Father, and I see I'm a builder with him. I'm a builder with him. Jesus is referred to as a builder of his Father's house. That's why he said, what I see my Father doing, that's what I do. He's a builder of the house. So the supernatural is given for the building of lives, the building of people. And so we can be sons of the prophets. This church was birthed out of prophetic movement many, many years ago, incredibly famous. I remember coming to a New Life meeting in New Zealand where Pastor Kevin was preaching and teaching and wanting to draw on this legacy that was in this movement. And this is in your house. So therefore, it's something for you to take hold of and hold it in your life. That means you're functioning easily and regularly in speaking into the lives of people. That's where there's a cutting edge. You'd be surprised when we carry that flow of supernatural power and wisdom, how it enables you to help people and touch people, and it takes the labor out of it because you're flowing at a place of rest. I'll talk about that in a moment. Okay, a builder of the house. So that means we're called to build relationships. We're called to build a spiritual atmosphere. We're called to build the culture of the house. We're called to build the lives of people through evangelism, discipleship. We're builders. We're builders. That's what it means to be a son. You are a builder. And so it says, seek to desire the gifts of the Spirit, desire that anointing and power of the Holy Spirit. But in 1 Corinthians 14, but seek to excel in building people. Be a great builder of people. And I believe one of the best ways we bring help people is we bring them into a place of experience and encounter with God and help them to walk with Him. If people can be developed to walk in the Spirit, walk with God, you've fed them for a lifetime. If we just feed them, they become dependent. And so God, I believe in this hour, is bringing tremendous transitions to the church, which bring much greater empowerment within the ordinary people, empowering them to carry the life and power of the Spirit. Oh, very quiet. Okay, so let's have a look there. So, notice what their cry was. Let us go down to the Jordan. Go down to the Jordan. So there's a passion in them for enlargement. There's a passion in them to expand. And the place that you start off that expansion, he said, was Jordan. Let's go down to Jordan, which means to sink down or to lower. It speaks of, first of all, change, something letting go, something new happening. They crossed the Jordan. The old life in the wilderness was gone. There was a new life. A new season came. The Jordan means humility, coming to a place of surrender to serve. It's a place where people were consecrated. Jesus began his ministry submitting to the leadership of John, emerging out of the Jordan into a new walk and flow of ministry and power. So it speaks of all of those things. So in coming into a season of transition, there's also for all of us a change. No one doesn't go through a season of change. So you welcome that God is bringing change. How can I humble myself, position myself so that I can flow with what he's wanting to change? No change is comfortable because usually something that's old that we like, we let go of in order something that's new that will bring us into the new season is embraced. That's what it involves. There's no shortcut to it. So when God spoke to me about the transition I needed to make, he woke me up one morning and I heard this word, shift in leadership, change in leadership. I thought, oh, God's talking to me. And I went out for a prayer walk. As I went out in the prayer walk, God just began to download to me, spoke to me very clearly. This is how he did it. He spoke, and see, this is why you need that revelatory flow from heaven. What he did was took me back in time to when he first called me to ministry, and he renewed the call again. And in a moment, I just started to weep and weep and weep, and I realized one season has ended, but God is calling me to a fresh season. So, see, how I serve changes, but not who I serve and what I'm called to do. See? There's some change takes place, but it's for enlargement's sake. And so I remember I did my time of grieving, because always transition take some grief. The things you like, which you're comfortable with, you let go in order new things can come in. So they went down to Jordan, and there they go, and they begin to apply themselves. Now, you notice here that one of them is chopping down the tree. He's cutting wood. The iron axe head fell into the water. He cried, "Alas, master, it was borrowed." Remember what we said? The axe head is a prophetic picture for us of the anointing of the Holy, the power of the Holy Ghost, and the wisdom of God. You need the two together. It's the wisdom and the power of God. Wisdom means I know what to do and when to do it. I'm in a flow where God is directing me. Power is there's an enablement of the Holy Ghost that comes with it. So we need those things. Now, if you've ever had an axe, you'll notice that there's the long handle, the wooden part of it, where human effort is applied. There's the cutting edge on the end. Now, if you have an axe without an axe head, all you got's a wooden stick. It is really hard to get results. You can put your back into it. You can put all your effort. You just can't get results. It's a lot of stress, a lot of effort, and not so much result. And the reason called no axe head. And I noticed, because I've had situations where I've lost an axe head off the end of an axe when I was chopping wood, I've become much more aware of axes. And if you notice with an axe, they usually have the axe blade, and they have the handle goes through it, and then they put a little wee wedge in. Isn't it interesting that the thing that keeps it all operating is so small? It's the wedge that keeps everything in place. If the wedge goes, your axe head will slip off like that. So, isn't it interesting to have that flow and that cutting power, that cutting force, which enables you to be successful, such a little thing holds it in place. And of course, if you lose that, then you've really got trouble. So, that raises a couple of questions. What holds the axe head in place? What holds the anointing flow and power and wisdom and life of God in place? Because if that's weakened or missing, then you will lose the cut. Now, usually when we lose the axe head in our ministry, we don't notice it. It's just gradually we get worn down because it's getting really hard and you're not getting the same results. Until in the end you get so disheartened, you think, I don't know whether I should be in leadership anymore, wonder if this is my time. And that's the thought that comes through. So, but it's a small thing. So the first, let me give you a few things that make up the wedge. It's never just one thing. But the first thing is intimacy with the Holy Spirit. Intimacy with the Holy Spirit is the most vital thing to keep the edge in place in your life. It's something no one can do for you. You need to check your life. Am I hearing the voice of God continually? Now, in groups, I love groups. Groups are necessary for growth, and I understand when Pastor Mark was saying that, you know, most of the 600 that left were neither serving nor in groups. I get that completely. That's exactly what happens because they're not building the house. They're loners, and they're not connecting. It's a real challenge. But one of the things I found helped me when I was doing small groups was to ask two questions. Now, often in groups, people don't connect very deeply. It's quite superficial. And I learned that when I mentored a group of men, to always ask them two questions. And those two questions would pretty well tell me whether the axe head's in place. And here's the first one. What has God been speaking to you about this week from His Word? Now, you notice I'm checking out whether the Holy Spirit is quickening the Word of God to them. So we're checking out, is there a real connectedness to God? And if they can't say what God has been saying recently, then they're losing the wedge that will hold the axe head. It's only time before the head comes off and they've then got troubles in their ministry. The second question I'd ask them was, what is the area of pressure you are under that we could stand and pray with you in? Now we've first of all asked about the God connection. Now it's about where are you living in your life? You know, when God first met with Adam, he said, his first question, Adam, where are you? And we don't ask that frequently enough. Where are you? Where are you in your life with God? Where are you in your personal life? It takes a few questions to find that, but if you'll ask people that, you'll find they'll open up because no one takes time to find out where they're really living. There's a priest, God, hallelujah, it was glory to God. All the religious-y sort of stuff. And you just go a little further. Well, what's happening? And where's the greatest area of pressure on your life this week? Where could we stand with you and encourage you in prayer? That gets a bit more real and a bit more honest, doesn't it? See, so little things like that, intimacy. A second thing is I found is the actual surrender to the Holy Spirit. One thing to listen to him, but there's another thing to surrender and yield. We all want our way. And yielding takes place in lots of little ways in life. So I found I need to learn how to yield, how to be sensitive to him and yield to him. Because in the yielding to him, you keep yourself sharp. It's called obedience. It's actually letting him have his way rather than I've got my way and I'm doing it my way. Thank you very much. And God bless it. It doesn't work. You've got to learn to surrender. So surrender is quite an interesting thing because it's not surrender to do what God wants, to do it how he wants. And it's also literally a yielding inside just to be able to engage him. So I found those have been very important keys to keep it in place. There's other keys, but if you don't have those two operating, you're going to have trouble holding the cutting edge around your life. It's easy to grieve the Holy Spirit. So I found if you want to really stay in a cutting edge, what is it does he love that I could do in my life? And what is it he really dislikes that would grieve him? I got to stop doing those things. And if I ask people, being Pentecostals for years, tell me a few things that the Holy Spirit is really grieved by. For many, nothing comes to mind, which is appalling. You know, if you've been married a while, you usually know what your partner likes, don't you? If you don't, you're in trouble. Something's gone in that marriage already and you didn't notice. But you need to know what the spouse likes and what they dislike. And if you keep doing the things they dislike, there's a problem in the marriage. If you do the things they like, then there are certain things, benefits. Benefits? We won't discuss that any further. So how do you lose your cutting edge? See, it's very possible to lose the cut. When Paul's writing in 2 Timothy 1:6, Paul's writing to Timothy, he said, Timothy, activate and stir up the gift of God in your life. Why do you have to write that? Because the cutting edge was gone. Was he faithful? Yes. Was he loyal? Yes. Was he still functioning? Yes. Was he still in his position? Yes. But was there a cutting edge of the Holy Ghost? No. Something had gone out of his ministry that alarmed Paul so much that in both letters he talks about it. In 1 Timothy 4:15, he says, Timothy, don't neglect the gift of God. Why does he write that? Because he's neglecting it. And in 2 Timothy 1:6, Timothy, stir it up, activate it, engage. Let yourself be energized yourself again in the Holy Ghost. Why? Because he's lost something. What did he lose? Well, he lost the flow of power, flow of wisdom, the flow of confidence, the flow of courage, the flow of strength that only the Holy Ghost can give us. So how did he do it? How did he lose it? Well, in 2 Timothy 1:6, he had fear. Sometimes we just get intimidated by stuff. You get intimidated by the bigness of the problem, intimidated by the difficulties, intimidated by difficult people. Now, lots of things can intimidate you. And when you're intimidated, your spirit closes and you don't move in the power. So intimidation, fear is a big issue. That's why we build a culture where it's safe to flow and function. Then the gifts flow and there's a culture, an environment where they're activated and nurtured and the presence of God is moving. A second is neglect. Obviously, 1 Timothy 4:15, Timothy said, don't neglect the gift of God, meaning to despise it or consider of little value. Now, it's very easy when you're in a church where there's a strong leadership culture and focus on building leadership, to neglect the gift of the Holy Ghost, which is the gift God gave you to enable you to get your job done. He didn't give you two gifts. He gave you a person to help you. So we need to love that person and know how to work with them. So neglect. We just neglect intimacy with him, neglect listening to his voice, being aware of him. A disappointment can cause us to lose the cutting edge. Disappointment. I have found very easy. I met many Christians who once were serving strongly but got disappointed. get disappointed in a leader, get disappointed in something in the church, get disappointed in people you've worked hard, served, and then they walk away without a word of gratitude, complaining and taking two or three others with them. That is disappointing, to say the least. And it's very easy when you get disappointed to lose your passion and cutting edge, your fire again in God. You have to get over that. I've had heaps of disappointments. I made a decision that what people do is not going to change who I am. I'll be generous and gracious and kind and passionate regardless of what everyone else is doing, because I've chosen to live that kind of life. You understand? You can't let what people do determine what you're going to be. You must make the decision, you know. And so I went through a difficulty when people I'd built with walked away from me, and then someone inspired me with a great little one-liner. When people leave you, your life does not come to an end. Their part in your life comes to an end, because they chose to walk away and not value what you have to give them. How about that? Huh? How about that? See, encouraging, isn't it, eh? So disappointment can do it. In Luke 24, verse 13 and on, the disciples were discouraged and disheartened because the way they thought God was going to work didn't happen. And so they drew away from Jerusalem, where they were called, into a place called, whatever it was, on the road to Emmaus. Anyway, wherever it was. But it was a place of comfort. People used to go there to the hot springs and they'd drink wine and sit there and feel better. And lots of people do that when they move out or draw back from their calling and just, well, I just want to feel better and happy and good. I want to have a good life. There's no good life outside the call of God. There's none like that. See, weariness can cause you. Just being wearied because you've not balanced your life up, you've worked too much in your own effort. All of those things can cause you to lose your edge. Get physically tired, emotionally tired. You got to learn to hold and maintain your whole life with God. That's your body, your fitness in your body, your emotional strength, and your spiritual strength. You got to maintain all of those things, or you lose the edge in it. Eh? Spiritual warfare can cause you to lose your cutting edge. So we find with Elijah. Elijah did nothing wrong. He was doing everything right. He had a move of God. Everything was going really great. And then the spirit of witchcraft came against him. Intimidated him, he lost perspective under the pressure. Under pressure of lots of things in your life, you can lose perspective. And then when he did that, it's found in 1 Kings 19, he began to draw back and isolate. He drew away from relationship, isolated, then he became passive, sat down, then he became depressed. Now, you don't say, well, you're such a good leader, that would never happen. I've had that happen on many, many occasions. I got in tremendous spiritual conflict, and that's how it affected me. I felt quite low and down until I worked out what it was all about and how to deal with it. Because what it did was, in the end, God comes to him, not to rebuke him, but he just asks a question. Don't you love it that God asks questions? You know the Bible, you know, where are you? Adam, where are you? Who have you been listening to? Or did you eat the fruit of the tree? See, it's very simple questions. So when Elijah is at the far end of the country, as far away from his assignment as he can get, God says, Elijah, what are you doing here in this cave? Maybe that's a word from God for some of you tonight. What are you doing in your cave? You don't belong there. You have a call. I need you. I have a positioning for you. Something for you to accomplish no one else can accomplish. What are you doing in the cave? And then, of course, when God asks questions, he knows the answers. It's just getting you to think about your life a little more deeply. And so then he begins his speech. Well, you know, it's so bad and everyone's out to get me. I'm the only one who's been faithful. Don't we get, I'm the only one. We get that. There's a very easy trap to get into. I'm the only, well, look what I've done. You know, and all the sacrifice. God says, what are you doing in the cave? Arise, go back, face your assignment, and now delegate the ministry out and spread the load, raise up others. Sometimes that's what the problem is. We got all caught up in our own ministry and didn't raise up others. So it's easy to lose it. Offense is another reason people can lose their cutting edge. You get offended, very easy to get offended. You know, and people get offended everywhere. I find them everywhere in churches. And then if they don't deal with the offense, they become quite bitter. I remember I was in one meeting, and it was an Asian meeting, actually. It was a wonderful meeting. And I was, I felt the Lord tell me to teach on bitterness, dealing with bitterness in your life, and all the signs of bitterness. And so I shared all that, and particularly wanted to address the bitterness against parents. And so I felt the Lord just give me a strategy, and that's divine wisdom, see? Makes it easier to do the job. He said, don't just pray for them, let them go overnight and think about it and give me a chance to work on them. So I said, when you go home, write an anger letter, write out a letter and honor your father, and then talk about the things which have been difficult or destructive and how it's affected you. Until you got all your heart out there, then forgive. And bring the letter tomorrow, we're going to pray for you. So do that for your father, do that for your mother, if those are where the issues lie. So come back tomorrow with the letter. And so we came back with a letter. I said, now everyone is now got out on paper what's in their heart. So that's a good place. Now you know what you're letting go of. And so I said, we're going to line up and I will lead you to the cross where Jesus faced injustice and hardship and bitterness and forgave. And I want you to follow me in a prayer and let it go. And then as we worship God together, we'll come and I'll just take this out of your hand and pray for God to set you free. Bitterness and all the stuff that goes with it. So you let it go, I'll pray and God will touch you. So that's what, it's quite simple, not hard, is it? So anyway, we started well. Everyone's praying in the spirit. Wonderful atmosphere of God, and the power of God is present to touch people. And I put my hand out in the air, they let go, and the power of God hit them. Let go, and the power of God, hey, what? Suddenly I found one. And they're holding on, and they're pulling. My first response is to try and pull. We've got a tug of war going here. And the Lord woke me up and told me what's going on. He said, you can't pull it out of their hand. They've got to let it go. He said, then he said a second thing. He said, that's what bitterness and unforgiveness looks like. They won't let go. Oh, okay. You need to choose to let go. And sometimes there were such deep spirits of bitterness and hate, it was only when we got them delivered, they let it go. See, offenses are everywhere. These are students, these are people committed to serving God, yet unresolved stuff. Unresolved stuff. You lose your cutting edge. You lose your cutting edge. Okay, so how can we get it back? Notice what he said, oh, it was borrowed. Not even mine. Now, when people break through and get an anointing or mantle on their life, if they're in leadership, it comes over the whole church. And if you're following that person and serving them, then they are entitled to taste, to carry, to draw from that mantle that's over the church, whether it be teaching or prophetic or whatever it is. So if the mantle expands and develops other dimensions, then that comes on you easily. So I expect everyone in our church, all can hear the voice of God, all may prophesy, all may flow with the Spirit. I expect it to be normal, because it's part of their legacy. But there's one thing to be operating under someone else's anointing, another thing to carry something yourself. And what happens, you get in a church and be in a leadership team, you find you can do lots of things, and for many people, they go out and try it on their own and then realize they haven't got what it takes. They went on their own rather than actually being commissioned and learning how to carry an anointing and make it their own. And then the wheels fall off them very quickly. So in order to make something your own, you have to pay the price. This man had never paid the price. It was a borrowed asset, and he lost it. So anyway, once you've lost the asset, it's really hard to get the job done. It becomes difficult. I remember being, when I was a very young Christian in a high school, and I was so young I didn't know anything. Just filled with the Holy Ghost, had passion, had prayer. That was it. Went for it, and we had a move of God. And I didn't know what a move of God was. If you told me it was a move of God, really, is that what it is? What does that look like? But when it went, then I knew it was a move of God. It was so hard, just so hard. Everything we did got little results. And then I learned what a move of God is. When God is moving and there's a flow of a river, you need to guard that. It's precious, very precious. So as leaders, your role in this next season is crucial. That you stand in a place of prayer and faith, that the church retains its axe head and comes to even another level. You have a vital part in doing all that. No doubt Pastor Mike will talk about that. But I want to talk about how you can personally get your axe head back. It's not that hard. But the first thing is to know you lost it. Notice he said, alas, I lost it. There was a grief that there was no axe head. Does it grieve you when there's no flow of prophetic, no flow of the Spirit, when things are tight? Is there a grieving in your heart? Something's wrong. When you're spiritually sensitive, you'll always feel whether there's an open heaven, an open atmosphere, and a flow of anointing around your life and into your meetings. That's the first thing I look for. And if it's not there, it's the first thing I want to address. I'm very sensitive to there being no presence of God flowing in my life or in the meetings I'm a part of. I want to know why and want to address it and shift it. Because I don't just want a meeting. I don't need a meeting. I'd prefer to be fishing. Be much more relaxing and much more pleasant. So to me, it's always a decision. Change the atmosphere. Do what's needed. There's a when the Holy Spirit is quenched, the normal response is to feel a grief. So notice he said, alas, oh, there's a grief. So have you lost something of God you once carried? There should be a grief. God, I want that back. I want the fire. I want that passion. I want that willingness to go out again and stretch out and prophesy and minister to people. Second prayer, he cried out. We need to cry out. Only God can give you that cutting edge back. It's not hard to get it back, but the longer you leave it, it takes more crying out in prayer to restore it. See? We need that cutting edge. So number one, we acknowledge, oh, I'm in pain. There's something wrong. This is too hard for me. And sometimes the first time you realize you've lost an edge is you realize you're worn down and you can't carry on. You just need the touch of God back on your life again. One of the ways I've learned that you can be aware the cutting edge is gone, there's probably a couple of ways. One is your loss of joy. It's all heavy, serious. Oh, another meeting. Oh, it's a burden. See? You know the edge is gone. Which for me, it's a joy. Oh, great. God's going to do something. This is exciting. See? The second thing that's lost is rest or peace. Because if the presence of God is strongly on your life, the first evidence of it is you're at peace. Now, that means you're resting, not striving to get things done. We're meant to live and walk out of a rest in the Holy Ghost. And that comes out of being able to let things go to Him and trust Him and work with Him, not trying to make something happen that we can't make happen. So those are sort of some signs of it. So notice what he said. Where did you lose it? I don't want to talk about that. Too embarrassing. Where did you lose it? If you've lost the cut, if you've lost the fire of God, if you've lost the flow of moving prophetically or words of knowledge or praying for people or ministering to people, if you've lost that and drawn back and you don't do that anymore and it's not a big part of your life and ministry, where did you lose it? Ask God if you don't know, but mostly when you stop for a moment, you know. Yeah, it was when they did that, I got really hurt. It's often as simple as that. That hurt me, and I made a decision to draw back and play safe. So you need to face it. So he made him face, and when he faced it, he took him to the place where it was lost. He took him to the place it was lost. So when we want to restore our cutting edge, you got to face, where did I lose this? What happened in my life that caused me to let go of my confidence in God and leaning into Him? I need to face that. And he took him back. And then there's two further things. The next thing, he got a stick, which in the Bible is always symbolic of the cross. And he threw it into where it had been lost. Wherever we've lost something in God, the cross is the place where that failure is paid for and resurrection is possible. You just have to come back to the cross in that area of your life. Is there something to forgive? Is there something to let go of? Is there a disappointment to bring to the cross? Is there some offense? Is there some discouragement? We come to the cross where Jesus poured his whole life out for us. And in that place, we can be restored because that's where resurrection will come. I've noticed in doing the deliverance ministry, if people won't face the issue and bring it to the cross, there is no freedom. There is no freedom. Demons understand that better than the church does. At the cross, legally every failure, no matter what scale, size, or however, was dealt with and addressed. I've got to actually apply the cross to that thing that has caused me to lose what I have. Come back again to the great love God has for me, to the price He paid for me, and then reach out. Now, the last thing is, he said, now you reach out and pick it up. He didn't do it himself and hand it to him and give it back to him. He said, there's a part you got to play. You got to first show me where it went, and I'll show you what the cross can do. Now, you've got to reach out yourself and pick this back up. you have to extend your faith and start to operate again in those gifts and flows of the Spirit. You need to walk out determined that the next time I'm with people and with any ministry or meeting, I will stretch again and operate in the flow of the Spirit. There's a stretch you have to make. Just like the man with the withered hand had to stretch, and in the stretch, the power was seen. There is a stretch to move in the things of the Spirit. I can tell you, the tendency I have is to draw back all the time. I got to keep myself in a place of strength in God to keep stretching out. Otherwise, I'll draw back. And so it's coming to the cross, Lord, you gave me everything. I set my heart back on you. I bring the failure to you. And now I stretch again to represent you in the realm of the Spirit. The church has got to stretch again. We need the supernatural. We need the power of God. In this season of my life, I'm stretching again to go further. I will not draw back and stay where I have been. There is more for this next season. The world is in upheaval. This upheaval is coming to every nation. I believe the power of God will be there to meet that need. But who will the people be who have got an axe head carrying something that can cut through and bring freedom and healing and release and enlargement, encouragement? Will it be you? Or will you be in a cave hiding somewhere? Will you be someone with a cutting edge? Tell you, people get a bit scared when they know you've got a cutting edge around your life. They get a bit wary of you because it's unexpected what can happen. They never know what's going to happen. I love it. Anyway, why don't we just close our eyes right now? We've come to the end of the meeting. Father, I just thank you for a wonderful, wonderful team of committed people. And I'm asking for your Spirit to touch people right now. Just close your eyes and I want people right now, if you know God spoke to you tonight that you have lost something of that cutting edge of the anointing and power and wisdom of God, tiredness has come, weariness has come, there's a loss of joy, a loss of rest, become quite a struggle. And if you know that's you, why don't you acknowledge it right now? Lord, it's me. I have lost my cutting edge. That would be the first thing to face. The second question is, where did you lose it? Holy Spirit, reveal to people right now where they lost that edge of faith, of excitement, of joy in the Spirit, of passion, of the life flow of God. Where did you lose it? Was it an offense? Was it a discouragement? Was it a setback? Was it spiritual warfare and pressure and you just got wearied? What was it? You may not be able to finger it completely or may not know quite one thing. There could be quite a number of things. Could be in your family. We went through a terrible upheaval with one of our children being abused. I lost my cutting edge there in a significant way until I could come back and trust my Father again. There may be some of you have struggled to trust God because something's happened in your marriage or in your family. Something's happened financially, been a setback. We need to set our eyes on things that are eternal. Because while we fix our eyes on things that are eternal, we become changed. They work for our good. So I wonder how many people here tonight, this was for you. You're just like that servant. Alas, the axe head is gone. What can I do? Would you raise your hand if that's you? Just put your hand up over the audience, over the congregation. There's so many hands coming up right now. I'm so thankful for your honesty. We can't fool people. We walk out, we'll just be the same if we don't respond. What if in a moment of time, God could come and touch you supernaturally and passion is restored again, fire is restored again? That would be wonderful for the church, for you, for your marriage, your family. Fire came back again. You've taken the first step. Now, why not take a second step? And say, God, I want to come back to the cross and remember the price you paid that I could live. I want to come back and where I've participated in losing this fire, I want to just repent of that. But I'm coming back to experience a fresh touch of God over me. And Lord, I will rise and pray and keep that anointing around my life. Touch me, Lord, tonight. Touch me, Lord, tonight. Break off that disappointment. Break off that fear. Break off that intimidation. Break off that spiritual conflict. Break it up my life. Touch me again. See, I found I need to be passionate. Passion's what you put into it because it's something really important to you. Why don't we rise right now and just begin to worship the Lord? And every person who put your hand up, would you come down to the front? I'd love to lead you in a prayer, and then we'll lay hands on you and pray for that anointing and touch of God, that whatever it is will lift off you, that fresh fire, and you will stretch your hand out and see God renew you again. Hallelujah. Come on, can you make your way to the front right now?